Good morning, everyone. Happy Father's Day. If you're not here, please raise your hand. I figured that. Wow. Aren't we blessed to have such a good group of musicians up here? Aren't they great? And I've been especially blessed today. My baby brother, Danny, is here. And I'm going to make him sing a song for you. So, Danny, where are you? Where are you, Danny? Oh, there he is. Come on in here and sing for Jesus. Ed is number 39.
Story of how I made it through when life was full of trouble, fear and pain. The answer may sound simple, though everything else crumbles. One thing has remained the same.
This old world
amazing me. Amazing God, you're still amazing me.
Amen. That was great, and we do appreciate that, and we thank the Lord, and we're so thankful to have all our fathers and all of you this today to join us in the Father's house and house of worship, house of prayer. So glad you join us and on the live stream, and we just welcome you to join us each morning. You know, and I thought today, as I was we was thinking about how great is our God and things He does for us in Psalms 46 is God is our refuge and our strength, ever-present help in trouble. Are you in trouble today? Therefore, we shall not fear, though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried away into the midst of the sea, because we can trust in our God. You know, I thought this morning if I might change something a little different. Would you stand with me this morning as we honor Father's Day? Let's say it's the Lord's Prayer. I think that's appropriate, don't you? Let's say it together. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed it be thy holy, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thou art the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Lord, we are thankful this morning that we can call out to you. You are our Father, Abba Father, God Almighty, the great I am, the I am, the Lord Jehovah, the great mighty God. We're so thankful, Father, that we can call out to you and for the love you sent thy Son, Jesus Christ the Lord. We ask you, Lord Jesus, your blessing upon each one this day, that you bless the fathers, you bless the families that gather in your name. Lord, that your anointing will rest upon your servants as your word is proclaimed this day and minister to each need. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And everybody said? Yes. Amen. Amen. God bless you. As Karen continues to lead us in worship this morning. God bless you.
Good morning, Harvest Chapel family. Good morning. I have something I wanted to say, and that's that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And my precious husband said to me one day, he says, you know, I held him at length for a while. He said, but when you let God be the Father that He wants to be to you, oh, honey, He's so good. He's so good. Yes, He is. So 1 Timothy 1:17, all honor and glory to God forever and ever. Yes. He is the eternal King, the unseen one who never dies. He alone is God. So let's exalt Him this morning with Hosanna. I love to go searching around and find out what the meaning to the story of the song is. Well, I did that again for this next song. But you know what? Something else struck me as I was looking. Frederick W. Faber had written several, like 150 hymns, but this particular one we're about to sing is his best one. Anyway, many of the great Americans who were fathers of our nation stood for what is right and holy in this country. And this is what I want to talk about this morning. Listen to what George Washington had to say. It is impossible to rightly govern the world without God and the Bible. Another one of our forefathers, John Hancock, said, "We recognize no sovereign but God and no king but Jesus." Then there was Francis Scott Key, who was the composer of our national anthem. He said, "The patriot who feels himself in the service of God and who acknowledges him in all his ways has the promise of almighty direction." Abraham Lincoln reminded us that my concern is not whether God is on our side. My concern is whether we're on God's side, because he is always right, right? So blessed is a nation whose God is the Lord.
Oh,
you, Lord. Just let's take a second just to stay in the presence of the Lord. Jesus. We love you, Lord. We invite you here, Father. Hallelujah. As we think of fathers today, we first honor God our Father. We're so grateful. You could sit for just a moment. Thanks. First, we're so grateful that we could recognize Pastor Phil, our father of the house. We love you, bless you today. We're very grateful for you. Our current culture, men have often been marginalized and masculinity is not really celebrated anymore. But the truth is that men, you are so important. You're crucial to our culture, to what God called you to be, the men of God. You're supposed to be the ones who show the love of God. You have a high mandate and a high call. So men and fathers, I hope that you know how much that we need you. You are meant to be leaders. You're meant to be strong and courageous warriors for God, influential, godly husbands, fathers, grandfathers, mentors, role models to your wife and children and grandchildren. So you're the bedrock and the foundation that our society is built, no matter what the media says. You are God's ambassadors here on earth. And even if you didn't have a great role model at home, a great father at home that was a role model of a godly man, you could be that one. So we call that for you today. Can you say amen? I'd like to pray for the men real quick before we call up the rest of the praise reports. And I just ask if the men who are fathers would stand for just a moment. And we're going to agree and just bless you in prayer first. Father, we love you. You are such a good father, and we are so grateful that you send Jesus, your role model, and how we should seek to live. Father God, I pray that you strengthen all the men here today. Give them courage to stand for the uncompromised truth of the gospel as men of God for your kingdom's sake. Give them a backbone of steel, I pray. Strengthen their character, that you would shine through them. Father, I ask you to bless every man here today that are Christ followers, that are in covenant with you, and always be with them, encouraging them, knowing they are not alone. Let them feel your presence even right now. They would know how much that you love them, Jesus. Father, we thank you according to your word, Proverbs 17:6, that you said, grandchildren are the crown of the aged, and the glory of the children is their fathers. Lord, I pray that you would teach men how to lead their families in love, and that is their primary emotion and not anger. Lord, I pray that each man in humility, not pride, and that you would move upon their hearts to be sensitive to the needs of their wives, children, and grandchildren. Walk in obedience as an example to them and influence their families for you, Jesus, and be led by your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. We're going to start out with a praise report as we call our elders forth to come and be able to anoint people and prepare. We have some great praise reports, and we thank God that he answers prayer. Lisa Kleen's husband, Ed, is home and cancer-free after 6 weeks at Moffitt. Hallelujah! Chris Williford continues to improve every day. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Barb Jagger's got a job, which is an answer to her prayer. Thank you, Lord. And Sharon Barton is getting better, and we are enjoying, and she's sitting here. Hallelujah. It was good to see you back, Sharon. Thank you, Lord. There's several people that have agreed to fast personal time of 30 minutes a day to read out loud the Word of God on behalf of Rich Henry. And for complete healing for the Word of God, we are still in agreement for Rich. Jesus, if anyone feels the urgency to join us in that, please feel free to do so. Of course, there's power in the spoken word. And the Lord says, give me back your word. Jeremiah 33:3 says, call upon me and I will answer thee and show you great and mighty things you do not know. So a few prayer requests. Dick Harding is in the hospital with a UTI, so we're going to agree for his healing. We pray for Lorraine and Chuck Latimer as they are going to be attending a funeral for Chuck's brother Jimmy, who passed away a couple of days ago.
Judy Sogren, I guess I'm saying that right, I hope. It's a neighbor of DZ Sweet, needs a prayer for the healing of breast cancer and a chest wall mass. But our God is a miracle worker. He is able, and we are going to believe for all these requests and more. This is a time right now that if you have a prayer need, that you would come forth. The elders are prayed up, and they're going to pray over you as we agree in prayer. Can we stand, please, as we agree in prayer together for the needs that we just mentioned and the ones that are coming up? Please feel free to come if you have a need to be touched. Thank you, Lord. Father, and you can also reach a hand out to the folks here, and if you're online, join us. Father, we boldly enter your throne of grace, seeking mercy for healing for all those that we mentioned in need today and the ones who are coming forth each day. We take up the whole armor of God to be able to withstand the devil and stand firm. No weapon against us shall prosper. We thank you, Holy Spirit, and we invite you into our lives and our hearts by the power and authority of Matthew 18:18. Whatever we bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever we loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. And if two or more are gathered, anything will be done for my Father in heaven. So we're many of us gathered here today. We unify our faith, believing for the healing of these reports that we brought forward and the ones coming forward. We lift up any people here today that may have earthly fathers that they've been wounded. We ask that you heal the hearts of people that have been wounded by their fathers and their emotions today. We ask if there's any bitterness or resentment that needs to be released. We call it to be released right now. Forgiveness in the name of Jesus by obedience. We call freedom and liberty here in the name of Jesus. If you have any strife in your family, amongst your children, to be reconciled, we ask that healing would come to families and they would be reunited. We choose love over every emotion. Lord, that you would do a healing and a reconciliation amongst families here today. We declare that you are breaching, you are repairing all breaches that are in our life. You are the repairer of the breach. Your healing would fill every crack in our foundation that would be firm. We ask you in the glorious inheritance to receive a fresh revelation for today. And we thank and give you praise this morning. In the name of Jesus, anoint this service. Oh God, we pray, moved by your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning, good morning, good morning. Wow. What a good group. Thanks for coming today. It's good to see Sherry and Rose back home again. Glad to have you here, girls. Yeah. We've been missing you. I want to begin with a compliment. Got all your attention now, don't I? So. You know, sometimes your body does not want to cooperate with your spirit. It's a struggle in itself. You get ready to come to church, your body says, nah, I don't think so. I'm kind of tired right now. I'm going to stay in bed. Your spirit says, you get up and you're going to go to church whether you like it or not. And by the time your body leaves church, it's glad that it followed the spirit instead of the flesh. Amen? A good example of that, my brother Danny, my baby brother, arrived at 3 o'clock this morning all the way from Illinois. And Danny, I'm glad to wake up. Hey, we're over here. No, bless his heart. So... Thanks so much for singing for us today, Dan. Appreciate that. Some of you people, when you leave and you come back and you go and you come back, we miss you. And I made a phone call to Bob and Marla Wilcox. They're on their... tripped all the way out to Colorado, and Marla's the only one that's driving. And I called her, and they were somewhere in Texas and eating breakfast. And I said, we miss you. And they said, we miss you too. And so I said, let me know what you look like. And so they took a picture for me, and they look like they're happy. That I had a premonition for Marla, though. I said, after you go all the way out there and come all the way back, you're probably going to say, I ain't going to do that again, you know. But it's an important trip. What's that? In a month. Yeah. Can you believe it? I just pray they miss us real bad. You know what I'm saying?
We have a work day every Thursday, and between 9 and 11, it's getting a little hot now, so some are coming a little earlier than that. Pastor Jan and I, when we were on our little drive and trip, we passed a church that the lawn needed to be mowed, there was trash everywhere, and it gave me an opinion about the place even before getting there. If it looks bad on the outside, it's probably bad on the inside too. But our people here clean the inside so well and the outside, and we have an inside team that, oh, yeah, there they are. I never know what kind of picture they're going to show up with. You know what I'm saying? There was Carol sneaking around the side, and there's Judy and Ira. You're supposed to put the tall guy in the back. Put the guy in the front. Then there's Hallie, and barely see Frida there, and then Rick. And right in the middle, and I first of all, I couldn't see it on my little synoptic printout here, but it's, I thought Clark and Bruce, I thought, is that Clark Kent and Bruce Lee? But realized they were all blood donors, and so they are heroes, exactly. Outside, we have a crew as well. We had Bill and Frank and Doug, and those guys came a little early, and I don't blame them because it's so hot out there. And so I appreciate all that they do to make the outside grounds. Now, give them a big hand. They did great. Also, you notice they're doing a lot of building around here. A lot of people are already here, and some are moving here. And building apartments and complexes all over the place, and they're all going to want to come to Harvest Chapel. Yeah, I'm snickering, you know, I shouldn't say that. But, you know, we have, Pastor Jan and I, our AC went out. And so we've been sweating it. And so we have new neighbors. Our new neighbors that have moved next door to us. And they're a young couple with two children and three dogs. And so they're a nice, nice couple. And I don't know if they must have heard Pastor Jan talking to a friend while we were out in the lanai trying to get cool about the air conditioning's off. And so the fellow with the name of Adam, he called us and he said, I've got an air conditioning unit that I could bring over to your house. And we put it in the bedroom, so at least we can sleep cool. And it's kind of like a motel room. You know, you got a bed and a bathroom. But anyway, we're there. When he was leaving after he hooked it up, I said, hey, Adam. Well, first of all, he said, are you a pastor? I said, yeah. He said, where? I said, I told him where, to Harvest Chapel here. And I said, Adam, are you a believer? And he said, yes, no. I said, it's okay. That's a choice every one of us have. And so we're just going to plant the seed in their heart a little bit and trust that they'll include God in their life. But there are a lot of people coming. If you want to know more about Harvest Chapel, Rich Henry does a beautiful job in keeping this up to speed, even though he did it while he's in the hospital and he's at home. He's got his laptop. And you'll find out who we are, what we believe, and the current pictures of different things that have happened and that will happen. So point people to harvestchapelofvenice.org, and I think it'll be a really good way of introducing people to us. Also, Rich told us about this Smile Amazon. If any of you buy on Amazon, they offer to give to a charitable organization such as Harvest Chapel. They pay whatever you buy, 0.5%. And so, like the first month this happened, there were $47 that came in extra, and then $27 the next week. And so if by chance you do buy something, it won't cost you any more. But you might as well take advantage of their offer as well. Okay? Are we agreeing? Yay! All right. Well, now Joan's going to come and tell us other things that are happening at Harvest Chapel. Welcome, Joan Popio, will you?
Well, happy Father's Day to the Love family here and to the Love family that is streaming us. And Danny, I have to thank you for that song. The message was just so pertinent for so many of us today. Thank you, thank you. I want to welcome everybody. And I want to extend an invitation to those who are not here for you to personally join us at Harvest Chapel every Sunday. We have services at 8:30 and 10:30. And it would be nice if some of you would get out of those pajamas and put that coffee down and start coming here where you can see and feel the love of Christ. Well, this is the time in the service where we have a little packet that we want to give to anybody who has never been here before. And the only way we can give that to you is if you raise your hand. Our ushers are here. So if this is the first time you have ever been here, or you haven't been here for a long time, please raise your hand. And I see a lot of faces that I've never seen before. And so raise your hand to get that little packet. And when you receive it, there's a little card in there. And whatever you feel comfortable putting on that card, please put it into that little chest that is in the doorway. And welcome, everybody. I hope you really feel the Spirit of the Lord, because He is definitely here. Today we have a birthday. It is Karen Sims' birthday today. We also have an anniversary today, and that is Larry and Luella Hale. And many of you will remember him for when he was here recently and gave us a message that we still have not ever forgotten. On June 21st, Charles and Rosalie McGill, Charles is in the back right there, happy anniversary. And to Bob and Bonnie Maui, my sister and brother back there. Did we miss anybody's birthday this week? Did we miss any anniversaries? Anybody here? Okay, thank you. Who? Oh, it's Danny's, your own brother? Okay. Happy birthday, Danny. Yes, happy birthday. That's because they didn't pick him up until 3 o'clock in the morning. So, you know, you don't think too well when it's 3 o'clock in the morning. Our Share the Word with Sue Mock meets every Wednesday afternoon from 3 to 4. We invite you to come and learn as we discuss the book of 1 John. And Miss Sue is doing a great job of revealing things that are between the lines that you don't ordinarily see. The power that you have being a child of God. After that, we sit in the presence of the Lord for 30 minutes. And I like Pastor Jan always says, it's an oasis in the middle of the week. We could use it an oasis around here and lately, you know. Our women's prayer group is led by Darlene Tintori, who is right here, and Carol Selvia, who is back home. We meet every Thursday morning right here, 10:30, and our prayer is a very powerful weapon, as you can hear by the testimonies that are given at both services. Our Sunday school class is taught by Trace Vintage and me. That's between services. It starts at 9:30. You are welcome to come in late, leave early. Sometimes that's the way it goes around here. We want to thank you for your faithfulness in giving, and we pray God's blessing upon you. If you are watching by live stream, then we've made it possible for you to give online, and all of that information is right now on the overhead. Next Sunday morning, Miss Gloria Elliott will be ministering at Harvest at both services. And if you don't know her, she is anointed in more than just her music. She is anointed in words and just her life. You are, buddy. Say it again. Yeah, well, okay, she's a hoot. Next Sunday night, starting at 6 p.m., Kevin and Donna Jessup will be continuing their series on revealing the word. You really don't want to miss that. The Mighty Men of God will be having their breakfast at Bob Evans next Saturday morning, starting at 9 a.m. I don't know how you're going to do that without Bob Wilcox, but I'm sure you'll figure out how. On July 2nd, the Woman of Faith will have their monthly brunch right here at Harvest Chapel. It starts at 10 a.m. There is a sign-up sheet on the back. I'm thinking ahead of myself. All I know is Pastor Jan and I were the only ones on it when I looked at it, so you better get back there and start signing the sign-up sheet for July 2nd. Also, we need some help on Thursday to work outside on the property. We probably need help on the inside as well. They start at 8 a.m. Sign-up sheet is in the lobby for that also. Be careful what sign-up sheet you have. There's three of them back there. I want to thank you for your help. Don't forget to put a smile on God's face.
Good morning. Scripture today is taken from Proverbs 4, and it begins, "Listen, my sons, to a father's instruction. Pay attention and gain understanding. I give you sound learning, so do not forsake my teaching. For I too was a son to my father, still tender and cherished by my mother. Then he taught me, and he said to me, 'Take hold of my words with all your heart. Keep my commands, and you will live. Get wisdom, get understanding. Do not forget my words or turn away from them. Do not forsake wisdom, and she will protect you. Love her, and she will watch over you.' The beginning of wisdom is this: get wisdom. Though it costs all you have, get understanding. Cherish her, and she will exalt you. Embrace her, and she will honor you. She will give you a garland to grace your head and present you with a glorious crown. Listen, my son, accept what I say, and the years of your life will be many. My son, pay attention to what I say. Turn your ear to my words. Do not let them out of your sight. Keep them within your heart, for they are life to those who find them and health to one's whole body. Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it." May God add his blessings to the reading of his holy word.
Thanks, Charles. Thanks, Charles. That was Solomon talking to us and talking to his son. You have to understand that Solomon, when he became king, he was overwhelmed with the enemies that are around him, the problems from within, the challenges that came his way, and he cried out to God, "God, I need your help." And God said, "What do you want?" And I love what he asked for. He simply asked for wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Well, that amazed God. He said, "You didn't ask for your enemies. You didn't ask for wealth. You didn't ask for help in trouble." He said, "I'm going to make you victorious over your enemy because you didn't ask for it. I'm going to make you richer than anyone else has ever been or ever will be because he asked the right things." That's what we need to ask for: wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. And God says, "I'm with you." Amen? How's your memory? You ever go into a room and say, "Why did I come in here?" If so, look guilty. Yeah, I can see. Well, we don't want to forget this important thing, so stand with me. This is our New Year's resolution that usually gets forgotten in a week. But we keep repeating it, and it goes in our ear and in our heart, and it makes a change in our life. And this is Psalm 34:1. Let's all say it together. "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will always be in my mouth." And everybody said, amen. You may be seated. Well, that will evermore change your life. Well, let me say happy Father's Day to you. Yeah. Some unsung heroes in many, many cases. And I appreciate my father. And I'm sure you appreciate yours. Sad part is, there's some that never known their father or have a bad relationship with their father. And this is the reason why we have a little trouble in our country right now. A man took his son to a local courthouse on his 18th birthday. The young man didn't know why they'd come until his father said this, "Son, I want you to watch what I'm about to do."
I'm writing my last child support check to your mother after 18 years. And now you're of age. Your mother's not going to get another dime out of me. I want you to go home and tell her this is it. And watch her face. Well, the young man said, okay, Dad. And he left and went home. His mother said, where have you been? And he told him what had happened. And then he said, oh, by the way, Dad said to tell you that he's written his last child support check and you'll not get another dime from him. Oh, and by the way, he wanted me to watch your face when I tell you. Well, told mother, and she paused for a moment, then said, oh my, this is going to make a major dent in our income. But please go back and watch his face when you tell him he's not your father. Well, today, there's so many father figures, and not all are fulfilling the important role in the family. There are fathers who've stayed on the job in difficult situations and fathers who've not stayed on the job. Some have simply fathered a child and they've never been seen since. Some who have assumed stepfather role have done a wonderful job, while others have even abused and the young and innocent under their trust. But God has called all fathers, according to Isaiah 1:17, to do right, seek justice, defend the oppressed, and take up the cause of the fatherless. So stand with me this morning as I read our text today. It's going to be a little different. This is 1 Samuel 12:16-25, and this is Samuel talking to a wayward Israel as a father figure, telling them how to return to God. God's hand and favor had been lifted off of them, and under the secular king they had chosen instead of Samuel, who God had appointed. And here's what it says. Now then, stand still and see this great thing the Lord is about to do before your eyes. Is it not wheat harvest now? I will call on the Lord to send thunder and rain, and you will realize what an evil thing you did in the eyes of the Lord when you asked for a king. Then Samuel called on the Lord, and that same day the Lord sent thunder and rain. So all the people stood in awe of the Lord and of Samuel. The people said to Samuel, pray to your God, the Lord your God, and for your servants, so that we will not die, for we have added all our other sins, the evil of asking for a king. Do not be afraid, Samuel replied. You have done all this evil, yet do not turn away from the Lord, but serve the Lord with all your heart. Do not turn away after useless idols. They can do you no good, nor can they rescue you, because they are useless. For the sake of his great name, the Lord will not reject his people, because the Lord was pleased to make you his own. As for me, far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord by failing to pray for you. And I will teach you the way that is good and right, but be sure to fear the Lord and serve him faithfully with all your heart. Consider what great things he has done for you. Yet, if you persist in doing evil, both you and your king will perish. Lord, I thank you for this word and this example that we can even apply to ourselves today. Lord, open our hearts and understanding. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said, amen. You may be seated. Well, this passage illustrates the importance of a father figure. The fatherly advice that Samuel gave Israel reminded them of what they had done wrong and what they needed to do to make things right with God. So I want to talk about father figures today. And here are the three things that Samuel mentioned as fathers should do to lead their family. First of all, the first job of a father is to protect the family. The second responsibility of a father is to establish standards. The third role of a father
to his family is to spiritually lead. Well, a father figure can be anyone, in spite of their kinship or age. They can take on the role of leadership in a family, a person seriously. A father figure is a person who, without personal gain, offers security, advice, and wisdom. A father figure isn't a new concept throughout the Bible. The influence of a godly man has always had its timeless benefits. Moses was a father figure to Joshua, Elijah to Elisha, Paul to Timothy, and even Joseph to Jesus in those early days. They were father figures who lived their life as an example that those would follow them and fulfill their leadership role. I've often said, your kids are watching you. They're watching Dad, how he does business, how honest he is, how he deals with anger. And they watch our lives. And it's so important that we realize we are an example in our life. But today has probably been one of the most important moments in history, for we need father figures in our nation. It seems like fatherhood has been more abandoned and demeaned and rejected in society, and the results are obvious. I don't know if you've noticed or not, but even on commercials, they demean Dad instead of esteeming him. I think Father Knows Best would not even go over now. You know what I'm saying? But in a subtle way, they make it to show the kids no more than Dad. And that's not the way it's supposed to be. Dad is supposed to have input into their lives. In years past, children were taken to church by their father. If I wanted to eat at Dad's house and sleep there and stay there, I better go to church or find another place to live, if you know what I'm saying. But in the culture today, we've lost our desire to honor God. I believe God is calling dads to seek God's wisdom like never before. So the first thing that Samuel instructed Israel to do as a father figure is to protect the family. A home should be a place of safety, a place of security, and a place of peace. Fear should never live in our home, whether it's from the without or from within. The very first thing Jesus would say when he entered a house or greeted people was, "Fear not," because he knew that fear was always at our door. And all the world is using fear now, like never before, to keep us all afraid. Satan is a major threat to our homes, and he will instill fear in every room of our house if we allow him. Jesus said, "How can anyone enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man? Then he will plunder his house." Satan has certainly tied the strong man in our households today. And he's plundered the most valuable possession a father has, and that's his family. A father had a 3-year-old daughter who was having trouble sleeping. She'd often wake up several times in the night, and she was afraid. So she'd run into mom and dad's room and jump in bed and have fear. So dad would take her back to her bed and tuck her in and remind her that Jesus is with her and that he'll keep her safe. Well, several nights in a row, the same routine over and over and over again. Finally, one night, the dad asked her, "Sweetheart, have you asked Jesus to take fear away from you?" And she said, "Yes, Daddy, I have. I prayed to Jesus, and he told me to come and get you." Can't get ahead of the kids sometimes. We're many times afraid. We're afraid when we're in trouble. We're afraid being threatened. We're afraid we're about to lose something. Sometimes we're afraid because we've done something wrong. You know, there's an inner feeling of knowing. If you've had a father that's instructed you, you know when what you're doing is wrong. It's just something within you that lets you know that. And we also know that following doing something wrong is punishment. I know what he'll say. "I told you so."
Sometimes it starts with a reprimand, and he'll tell you where you went wrong. But he also loves us, and we know if a father is imparted the love that they need to hear, they'll know you get treated fairly, and dad will show you how to get out of trouble. This is the scene with Samuel in the wayward Israel. They sinned against God, and they knew it. They sinned because they'd rejected Samuel as a leader. He's too religious for them. Oh, we don't want to have somebody too religious at all. And they demanded a king like all the other nations. They rejected Samuel as a leader, but even more, they rejected God. Does that sound like America to you? Samuel rebuked the people, and God sent a powerful storm of thunder and lightning and rain. Well, the people got the message. They saw the Heavenly Father's power he had to punish. And they begged Samuel to pray for them. Here's 1 Samuel 12:19. The people all said to Samuel, "Pray to the Lord your God for your servants so that they will not die, for we have added to all of our sins the evil of asking for a king." In the midst of their fear, they asked Samuel to pray for them. Isn't it something? Your kids may not be living for God or going to church and doing the things they should do, but I mean to tell you, when they get in trouble, they call you, "Oh, please pray." Sometimes when God answers the prayer, they'll even call back and say, "Hey, God answered the prayer," until another problem comes along. "Dad, will you pray?" There's a reason why. Because they've been taught the power of prayer. Thank God for fathers and dads and father figures who take their role seriously and protect the loved ones from any and all threat. We honor today the fathers this morning who impart wisdom and advice and love. The second thing Samuel instructed Israel to do as a father figure was to establish standards. Look, any and every game that's played by children or adults has rules. Without rules of the game, it can't even be played. I mean, you don't take a baseball bat to a football game. It don't work. We understand that in sports, but we miss the simple analogy that comes in the family. Without established standards, a home is chaotic. Members turn against one another and argue. Arguments dominate the atmosphere. I don't know if you've ever been in a home at all, but they're putting one another down, demeaning one another, finding fault in everything. Nobody gets picked up, but always put down. That's the kind of home we don't want to be in. But I'm telling you, if you don't have at least some standards of what is acceptable and what is not acceptable in your home, it can be chaotic. It can. Every household needs establish standards so that each member of the family knows to obey and understand that there's a penalty, a penalty when you break the standards. Getting awful quiet in here. Are you going home in your head at all? Establishing standards of conduct in a home isn't the sign of a domineering dad, but it's the sign of the father's understanding his leadership role in the family. So many dads today want their children to be their best friend. Your kids don't need any more best friends. Your kids need a father. You see, because a father will be there when the good friends have walked out. Dad will always be there. I know being a father figure isn't always the most popular person to be in the family. It's not the most desirable position to hold, but father should be the glue that holds a family together. One of the basic responsibilities of a father figure is to be a family disciplinarian. I know you don't like that word. Hebrews 12:9 says, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respect them for it. In the account I read about
Samuel and the judge of Israel, he had established standards for God's people, and sometimes he told them things they didn't want to hear. You know, hear me now. There's some things your kids don't want to hear from you. But it says in Samuel 16:4, when Samuel went to anoint David, the next king of Israel, it says, when he arrived in Bethlehem, the elders of the town trembled when they met him and asked, do you come in peace? It's kind of like, wait till your father gets home. You're in big trouble, mister. Sounds like just a child who's done the wrong thing. And he knows he's broken the rules and there's going to be a punishment. Evidently, the elders were afraid of Samuel, and he knew that they'd done something wrong, and they knew they were going to get punished. Does this sound familiar? This is going to hurt me more than it does you. Well, give me the paddle, we'll see. Well, loving fathers and father figures establish standards of what's right and wrong in the home, and they're willing to be the bad guy when they need, because the future of our children depends on their decisions that they make, right or wrong, in this life and in eternity. 10 years ago, a study was done, and it was found that conservative Christian parents, whose parenting style was described as authoritarian, had raised some of the most well-adjusted kids. American Enterprise magazine did a national survey of families and discovered that most Christian parents have consistent and firm discipline as well as love and parental guidance. In other words, fathers in their homes have set a firm pattern of what was and what was not acceptable in their home for their kids. That's the kind of father figure Samuel was. He was the firm and authoritative leader that Israel needed. He was willing to look the children of God in the eye and tell them exactly what they needed to hear. According to Moses, it's a father's responsibility to let his children know where the boundaries are. Deuteronomy 22:8, he warned, when you build a new house, you must build a railing around the edge of its flat roof. That way, you will not be considered guilty of murder if someone falls from the roof. What in the world is that all about? Well, back then, they build houses with flat roof, and then they build, when the kids get married, and they build another story. And the flat roof is where they would get together. It's like a living room, you might say. They would eat. They would speak with one another. But Moses warned them, make sure you put a banister, a rail around the outside. If you don't do that and one of the kids falls, blood is on your hands. What's it got to do with us today? Well, I want you to know today the railing on the roof is an invisible, established standards of what a father figure portrays. We'll get to that later, all right? this is an analogy of that we better give them something to come back to. You know, the Bible says, raise up a child in the way they should go, and when they get old, they'll come back to it. You've got to give your kids something to come back to. I promise you. Most everyone in the world is going to be challenged to leave those standards that were portrayed in the home. There'll be temptation to come their way by their other friends, pulling them away. But I want you to know, if you give them something to come back to, that is the most important thing, because the Bible says they will come back if you give them that standard. Samuel said to Israel, you know where the boundaries are. Your father figure needs to be a disciplinarian to punish when they've crossed the line, but with firm and loving kindness. But that's the danger of dads who are disciplinarians. Some forget the love factor that needs to be established stronger than anything else. Without the love factor, a father can be harsh, can be insulting,
and go overboard, and how they treat their kids, and they can drive their kids away from them. The Apostle Paul warned the Ephesians, "Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord." He went ahead and told the Colossians, "Fathers, do not embitter your children, for they will become discouraged." I hate to admit it. There are dads in the world that their main goal is to keep their kids under their thumb. God says, "I want you to keep them in your heart." The number one thing that a father figure needs to say to their children is, "I love you." You know, I have met some people who said they've never heard their dad say, "I love you." I guess back then you were just supposed to know it by the fact that he worked hard and kept food on the table. Kids need to hear, "I love you," from the lips of their dad. Mom, it's not going to be a problem with mom. She's going to say it a lot. But dads have a problem with it at times. They even have a problem with saying it to their wife. The wife needs to hear it too. And kids need to hear it. Can you say amen? Amen. The number two things that children need to hear from their father is, "I'm proud of you." That's so important. It'll never leave your mind when your father has said, "I'm proud of you." Now, I've got my two brothers here today, and what I'm about to say, I've got the microphone. My dad and I were over at the barber shop, and just he and I. I was probably helping somehow when the others weren't, but I said, "Hey, Dad, I've been thinking about this." He said, "What's that?" I said to him, "Of all your boys, I think I'm like you more than all the rest." He looked at me and he said, "You're a good boy." It's all I needed to hear. And it just ringed in my ears all my life. I got my dad's approval by saying, "I'm a good boy." I don't care what he said to you guys. I'm just same thing. No. Yeah. A father's approval is so important. And I know that your kids can do things that you don't approve of. It breaks your heart. That's why I love that verse of scripture in 3 John verse 4. "I have no greater joy in all the world than to know that my children are walking in the truth." But I want you to know, with all that greatest joy, more than a Corvette you could buy or a boat or anything, knowing that your kids are following the Lord that you trained them to, it's a great thing. But it also can be the greatest hurt that you'll go through as well when you see that your kids are not including God in their life. But I want you to know this, may not be on your prayers. There was on television, a random father was asked, many of the fathers asked, one bit of advice you may give your children, what would it be? And one dad said it best. He said, "My advice to my kid is guard your name." That's why Samuel was referring to in verse 22 when he said, "For the sake of his great name, the Lord will not reject his people because the Lord was pleased to make you his own." The first job of a father is to protect the family. Second responsibility is to establish standards. The third important role of a father is to spiritually lead his family. This got my attention in verse 23. When Samuel said to Israel, "Far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord by failing to pray for you. And I will teach you the way that is good and that is right." Did you get that? A good father spiritually leads his family. He said, it's a sin. It would be a sin for me not to pray for my kids. I don't want to commit that sin. I'm going to pray for my kids and pray for them and pray for them. It's the greatest power that I have. A good father spiritually leads his household. Proverbs declares, that was already read by Charles, listen, my son, to a father's instruction. Pay close attention and gain understanding. I will give you sound teaching, so do not forsake my teaching. The Bible presumes that a father will instruct his kids and teach them. Deuteronomy 11:9 says, teach your children when they sit at home, as you walk along, when you lie down at night, and when you get up in the morning. Hey, that's pretty much all the day. Continue to talk to your kids about the good things of God. God has charged fathers with the responsibility to pray for their kids, for their grandkids, for their great-grandkids, and on down the line. A father's most important role is to teach them the way of what is right, what is good, and what is wrong. A father who understands the value of his role is in a children's life will make sure that they, when they make mistakes, that they be there for them, but they guide them in the right way. Believe me, your kids will know when father's praying. You have to ask yourself, have my kids ever seen me pray? Have my kids ever seen me worship the Lord? Has my children ever seen me raise my hands and worship before the Lord? It's so important that they're watching you every move. I mean, Bob and Dan and I, we weren't raised in church. We were jerked up in church. But we watched how the people worshiped the Lord and how they reached out to them. And we watched our dad. Hey, he was a barber. And that, back then, I remember when the barber with a haircut was went from $1.50 to $1.75. And Dad had a lot of ones in his wallet. I watched. When the offering came around, Dad didn't pull some ones out. He would go to the largest bill in his wallet and bring it out, a $20 bill, and put it in. I watched him. My dad blessed God because he knew that's where the blessings of God come from, and he returned that. God places a heavy emphasis and importance on father figures in scriptures because he is one. Like Donna said, he's our heavenly Father who art in heaven. Hallowed be his name. He wants us to be watching him and be the image of the God the Father. This morning, I've been talking about father figures. I talked with a young man this morning who Trace Vintage, who does a Sunday school class. I said, Trace, do you have any children? He said, I never had any children. I said, you know what? You can be a father figure to someone else you come across. You can embrace them, guide them, love them, and direct them, and they'll never forget you either because you're a father figure to them. First important job is to protect the family. Don't let the devil tie the hands of the strong man. Second is establish standards. I hope your fathers establish some standards in your home. And the third is spiritually lead your family. Stand with me this morning. I think it would be wonderful to do something a little different. I'd like all the fathers to come and stand at the front. All the fathers to come and stand at the front. Wow, what a responsibility been placed upon you guys. To protect, to establish, and to be a spiritual leader. Come on close. All the dads, come to the front. Good to see Larry here too, Larry. See you, buddy. Wow. And Grandpa, yeah, it's yours. Hey, man, God's depending on you. He really is. He's depending upon you to be the example that others will follow. I trust all of you had a godly father. If you didn't, it's a good place to begin. To be the godly father God wants us to be. I want all the rest of you to raise your hand toward these people, toward these men, as we pray for them. Lord, I pray that you will anoint these fathers like never before. Lord, give them wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. May they continue to pray for their children, no matter where they are, what they're going through, whether they can be proud of them or are hurt. I pray, God, that you will instill within them the desire to be everything that you want them to be. I pray, God, that if they have not established standards, that they will begin to impart the standards, telling their kids what's right and wrong. And when they call and want help, Lord, may these fathers reach out to God in their behalf. And I pray, God, you'll anoint them, surprise them with what comes out of their mouth, surprise them with the places they go and what you instill in their hearts. Strengthen these dads. They are so important in our world today, so important in our nation today, so important before you come back. You'll anoint these guys like never before. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen and amen. Isn't God good? What are you playing there, honey? What? Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Lord, I pray you send us out now as dads, those that are responsible. We know that the world is watching. I pray, God, that you'll give us an awareness wherever we are, that some others may only see what Christ can do in a life through us. Dismiss us now, I pray, in Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. God bless you.